Okay, well, trust is like, to me, nobody cares about what you know until they know that you care.
Right.
You know, I was told that by Coach Wooden when I first began my basketball career, you know, and he was telling me, he's like, because I was asking, you know, hey, I want to know about this system, this offense, that defense, and he told me, no one's going to care about what you know until they know that you care. So with that, I've always claimed that that was one of the most incredible things. When you hear and you read about books about the great leaders of corporate world or in countries, it's generally speaking, it's because the person that's the leader demonstrates care.
Right.
So I really try as hard as I can to ask about you know, how's their wife, how's their mom and dad, how's their kids.
Right.
You know, almost every time I don't talk about basketball.
Yeah.
Because I know that that's part of the job. I know that's our job to do for sure.
Yeah.
But the other time, I got to know about how to motivate you.
Right.
So for example, if I came to you today and I said, you know, listen, I don't know what the heck you're doing, man. You're not really running that well, and I don't know how come you can't make baskets today. You're just horrible today. But I didn't get to find out that today, you know, you've had an argument with your wife. Things just aren't going so smooth, and you know, and you're kind of down, then me cracking the whip didn't make you respond the way I wanted it to be. Didn't
right.
work.
Yeah.
It's going to have a negative effect. Whereas if I went the other route and I kind of knew what you were going through that day, and I massaged that by just saying, you know, by encouragement, you know, well, now I may not get the better result.
Yeah.
But I'm overall, I've won you because now you're saying that coach, that CEO, person, he cares about me.
Right.
And that's about as good as I can get, you know. He's not mad at me, you know, for my performance today. He just cares.
Yeah.
And now from that point on, I think now whatever you say is in a different world now. I think they listen to you better. I think they'll perform for you better. And in the athletic world, they call it going through a wall for you. And I think that's exactly what would happen. They'd go through a wall for you because then they defend you, you know, especially in the athletic world. When your athletes know that you care about them and that you're giving them all the expertise that you know how, and you're giving them everything they can, and they've gone out and criticism comes, they defend you.
Right.
You know, they're like, nope, that's not how it is. This is how we operate. And then now, you know, then the culture has been created where winning can take place, where achievement can take place.
Yep.
And because it all stems from the leader. It really does. I mean, there has to be for example, when a leader takes over a new company, there's people already within that company already established in their how they operate.
Yeah.
Each one's different.
Yeah.
But they're wondering to see, okay, well, what's this new guy gonna be all about?
Yeah.
Well, I had a meeting with him, and all he cared about was how many you know insurance policies I sell today.
Yeah.
No good.
Right.
You know, he doesn't even know the name of my wife. But if he does know, and he knows you're expecting, and he takes the extra care to send you a birthday wish, holy cow, you know, that's humongous, you know. Because to share someone's birthday, you know, is one of those big things, but to even care about it, to write it in a calendar, to take the time to type out happy birthday, have a great day, could mean it's the difference. It means he cares.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, Those things go a long way in my estimation as to when I look at leaders, I try to find them from everywhere and I try to see, are they purpose driven? You know, do they know exactly what they're going to be doing that day?
Right.
Another way is when I socially watch people and I see how they walk from point A to point B.
Right.
You know, are they taking a long time to get somewhere? Or are they walking very confidently?
Okay.
I mean, do they, is it a, you know, is it direct? Do they know exactly where they're going? How do they shake hands? Do they look you in the eye? That's a, those are those, what they call a first impression. And the first impression for a leader is formed in the first 7 seconds.
Okay.
It won't go away. From that point on, that person, whoever he meets, he or she meets, is going to have a judgment. And it's going to be one that was formulated within that first 7 seconds. They're going to watch how that person walked into the building. They're going to watch how that person is dressed.
Yeah.
And the handshake and the eye contact and personality. From that point on, no matter what you say, they take it into consideration. They're like, oh, great. Yeah, that's wonderful. You know.
Right.
But if it wasn't so well and it was sloppy or you were ignored, from that point on, you've got a long process of work. You're going to have to really work at trusting that person again or wondering what they're going to say to you or listen about. You're not going to really pay that much attention.
Right.
Because they didn't pay attention to you, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And do you think that's an area that people fail a lot?
I would, most certainly, I think that people fail miserably in the fact that they don't pay attention to that small detail.
Mm.
For example, I deal with a lot of athletes trying to put them into various jobs as professionally. And when they are sloppy in their appearance, the other team or general manager is going to formulate an opinion on them immediately. You know, I can tell a professional versus a guy who just plays.
Right.
So a professional walks in the building as a basketball player, and, you know, he's going to tie his shoes, he's going to have his shirt tucked in, or he's going to look nice, he's going to warm up properly, and then he's going to pay attention to detail and focus on things and probably say yes, coach, no, coach, and listen.
Right.
The other guy is going to have, you know, he's just going to come into the gym in flip-flops. He's going to have his shirt untucked. He's going to be loose.
Yeah.
And he's just going to play. And after the playing is done, he's going to go and look for another place to play.
Right.
It's just two different types of an individual and how they carry themselves.
Right. Okay.
And, you know, I completely concur, like the guys in the NBA, for example, on how they dress. It's professional. They're in suits and ties for the most part.
Yeah.
Going to the game and coming after the game for the most part.
Yeah.
And some people argue that's because of the salary. You know, I differ with that. It's not because of the salary. It's because they think like businessmen.
Yeah.
They become their own business. And if you think about that, you're a businessman, you think about profits and losses, and you also think about your image, and you think about what it is that you're offering. Because if I'm going to, for example, like my job now with Reebok, I endorse athletes. I give them a vehicle for the rest of their life to use, but not if they're not going to think like businessmen. You know,
yeah.
There's no way. That doesn't carry a good image. But the moment I talk to somebody about that opportunity or that, they shine, they rise up, they get a little bit different, they walk differently. That's what it is. That's what you want to do. You know, you're going to carry, you're going to give them something tangible to take. And that's really what I think the leader is doing. He's setting the bar, and he's helping them rise up above that bar. And if they're successful, then he or she as a leader is successful.
Yeah.
But you just can't make individuals do something if they don't believe in that common cause. And the only way they believe in that common cause is if you believe in them.
Yeah.
Then they'll take your ideas and run with it.